Okay, we're gonna ready for the home stretch here. First of all, before I introduce the next speaker, a few comments. First of all, I want to thank some of the sponsors for the meeting today. We had generous donations from both the Duro Biotech and Anacor, and we thank them. And of course, mostly we're supported by the generous gift from Sam Wheeler, which endowed our center for 20 years. And so we're not going away. I also want to thank all the speakers, especially those who've traveled so far. We have three speakers have come from either Australia or two from Africa, and we really appreciate it. It's those of you who have done these kind of trips. Yeah, Warner, thanks for coming over the bridge. You're a cheap date, though. Okay. All right. Is this being taped? All right, anyway, let's get to our talk. Today's speaker is Fidelis Cho-Ngwa from Buea, Cameroon. And one of the wonderful things about this symposium, from my perspective, is we get to hear about pathogens that we are not worked on in Berkeley. And this is certainly the case today. And so Dr. Ngwa works on onchocerciasis. And I know so little about that. I'm so excited to hear your talk. He's the director of the Onchocerciasis Drug Discovery Center at the University of Buea in Cameroon. And that is.
Thank you very much.
Oops. I think I'll help.
Okay, things fine like that. Once more, good afternoon. I'll be talking on onchocerciasis, a state of chemotherapy. State of chemotherapy and drug discovery activities at the ANDI Centre of Excellence at the University of Buea. Onchocerciasis, also known as river blindness, is a debilitating filarial disease, mainly of the skin and eyes. It is characterized usually by unbearable itching and skin eruptions, which are locally commonly known as craw-craw. It's the second leading infectious cause of blindness worldwide. It's highly neglected, infecting some 37 million people in tropical countries, of which about 99% of the people infected live in Africa. It is a disease of the poorest of the poor because we find it mostly in rural areas in the impoverished sub-Saharan African regions. In the next slide, we will see a map of distribution of onchocerciasis. We see here the African continent and where the disease is prevalent. But although we find the colors of the same shading for all the countries, we really don't have much of it in Central and Latin America. We have just a few people. Not so many people infected in this region. Like I said, 99% of people are here. And also an isolated focus here in the Yemen, Arabian Peninsula, which is Yemen. We find here some signs of the skin disease and symptoms of this disease. This is a case of you may think that this is a very old person, but it's not. This is a very young person who has been put in this situation by this disease. You find that the disease makes young people look very old, and then it gives the impression that this person has been burned by fire, but that is a case of severe skin depigmentation, which is known as tiger skin. And then here we find this individual with some nodules, you know, and that the adult worm lives in those nodules, subcutaneous nodules. So, like I said, the disease is highly destructive, unbearable itching, and fertile lands were abandoned because of this disease, especially in Ghana. Although there is a new publication that is saying that people abandon those fertile lands because of the nuisance of the black fly. You know, in some of those areas, you find so many black flies that it's almost impossible to concentrate, especially on farming. Life expectancy is reduced. Average life expectancy of the people infected by up to 15%. And this disease is also associated with epilepsy. There's a very close association between onchocerciasis and epilepsy, kind of indicating that there is onchocerciasis is responsible for epilepsy in some of those areas, but that is still being debated. It infects some 25 to 40% of Cameroonians, mostly in rural areas. In the cities, you really will not find many people with onchocerciasis. But we have some endemic villages where more than 98% of the people are infected, so almost everybody is infected. Onchocerciasis is transmitted by black flies of genus Cymolium. We find these black flies all over the world because we find animal onchocerciasis all over the world, especially onchocerciasis of cows, horses, deer, and so on. So we find black flies around. But there are regions in Africa where the black fly population is really high. And this black fly population is high around rivers because the breeding takes place around fast-flowing waters, as you see here. The black fly larvae require plenty of oxygen, high oxygen tension for growth. And so the disease is most prevalent around such rivers. That is why it is also known as river blindness. This is the life cycle of the ovovolous parasite, Onchocerciovolous parasite that causes onchocerciasis. And we find here an adult female worm. This is what lives in the subcutaneous nodule. And then in this life cycle, we see a black fly biting man, for a female black fly, for a blood meal, because they require blood like mosquitoes for reproduction. So it ingests a microfilariae, which microfilariae develops into adult males and female worms, and then, an infective stage larvae, L3, which then develops into adult males and female worms. And this female worm now releases or produces thousands of microfilariae, which microfilariae may be ingested taken up by a black fly, and then the microfilariae develops through the L1, the L2, the L3, which is the infective stage larva, and this moves to the mouth part of the black fly infective stage larva, the L3, can be given to another person during the next bite, the subsequent bite. And so the cycle continues. And this is a picture of the ovovolous microfilariae. There is no vaccine for onchocerciasis. No cure. A cure will be a drug that will kill the adult worm, because the adult worm can live in the human body for 15 to 18 years. And so if you don't kill the adult worm, it stays in the human body to produce more microfilariae, which continues the life cycle of the parasite. And so you need to kill this adult worm in order to have a cure. And so there's no drug at the moment that's recommended for killing the adult worm. There is also no suitable point of care diagnostic test for onchocerciasis. Presently, you have to get a biopsy, a skin biopsy. You have to pinch somebody's body using a blade or a corneosclera punch. Nowadays, they use blades. And put that biopsy in some culture medium and then observe under the microscope to see if microfilariae will come out. And this test has a problem of sensitivity. Things, and that sensitivity depends a lot on the prevalence and intensity of the that infection in that community. Ivermectin, otherwise known as mectizan, is a microfilaricide killing the first stage larvae. It's currently the only drug that is recommended for onchocerciasis. And mass drug administration with ivermectin is a main control weapon for this disease. It is often combined with vector control, where breeding sites are being treated with insecticides and larvicides. And ivermectin is donated freely by Merck through the Merck donation program. And you find here a group of inhabitants of some village taking the drug. Ivermectin prevents most of the clinical symptoms of onchocerciasis, but like I said, cannot cure it since it cannot kill the adult worm, and limits transmission by suppressing production and release of microfilariae from adult females, and this happens for generally 6 to 12 months. So if you take ivermectin, you have to wait for about 6 to 12 months to take it again, and you have to do so for over 10 to 14 years to virtually cover the lifespan of the parasite. But if you have to use ivermectin as a control tool, some people have argued that you need to continue treatment for up to 25 years to be able to see elimination. And even so, that will be very difficult to come by. So the only way is to get a cure. Ivermectin is contraindicated in pregnancy, but since the benefits may outweigh the risk, you know, pregnant women may still take it. And I said a while ago, it's given freely by Merck and Co. since 1987. This has to be so because you really cannot make money on an onchocerciasis drug. Like I said, it's a disease of very poor people. And so if you wanted to sell it, you'd just be, you know, wasting your time. If you really wanted to make money out of it. And this is a challenge with a neglected disease like onchocerciasis. Also, ivermectin treatment of onchocerciasis in areas where onchocerciasis is co-endemic with loasis. Loa is another filaria parasite. And so when you have onco and loa, you know, being in the same locality, if you are treating for onchocerciasis, you have this lower microfilariae in the blood. And when the number is important, when the number is so large, usually greater than 8,000 and above, you find that the drug ivermectin kills thousands of lower microfilariae in the blood at the same time, almost simultaneously, almost at the same time. And so there is this serious immune reaction that results from the detritus to the debris, results from dying microfilaria of lower in the blood, and that often leads to encephalopathy and death. So the fear of ivermectin is also one problem that is preventing elimination of this disease using ivermectin. People are afraid, just afraid to take ivermectin, especially in areas where we find that co-endemicity. If you look at it, you see that there are some areas here in West Central Africa where onchocerciasis and loasis are co-endemic. But the disease is almost eliminated in Latin America, possibly because we don't have ivermectin, we don't have loa, possibly also because of maybe proper organization or the prevalence was not so high initially, you know. And in Africa, they tried to use vector control to get it off from the savanna regions. But when it came to the forest regions, to use helicopters, for example, to do area spraying became so difficult because the forest canopy was preventing the insecticides from reaching the larvae in the rivers and the and the vectors, the flies, on the grass. Now, there are also reports, so many reports, of resistance. Some have talked of low response rates of ivermectin to Onchocerca microfilaria. The ID drug for Onchocerciasis will be directed against the adult worm, which will be a microfilaricide or a cure, and will be inactive or very poorly active on the lower microfilaria at a therapeutic dose for ovovolus. This is because, like I said a while ago, if you are going to be treating for Onchocerciasis and you have plenty of lower microfilaria in the blood, you will have this problem of maybe some people dying, people who have large number of microfilaria of lower in their blood. And of course, if you can have a short course of treatment or one of those, will be preferable because this is a chronic disease. It's unlike malaria, where you know that if you don't take it, you will die. If you don't take the drug, you will die. But with Onchocerciasis, if you don't take the drug, you're not going to die directly from the infection. Of course, that infection may lead to other things, and then you die of those things. But it may take you maybe 20 or years, or the worm may just die and go away, and you survive. And so it is important that you get a drug with a short treatment course. And this is why antibiotics, although they have been tried, they have been tested in experimental settings, you cannot really use them to treat Onchocerciasis because you have to take antibiotics for up to 6 weeks, to even 6 months. Some reports have talked of 6 months to be able to kill the parasite. And the antibiotics are actually killing Wolbachia endobacteria, symbiotic bacteria, in the worm. And so if you deplete Wolbachia, the worm will not be able to function properly, will not survive. And so depletion of Wolbachia will lead to worm death. And the long treatment course with antibiotics is unrealistic. We also know that you cannot use antibiotics in mass drug administration campaigns where you enter a population and you start giving antibiotics carelessly. In the United States, in Africa, it's not so controlled, but I know that in the United States, you cannot take antibiotic without a prescription. And so it's a problem there. Okay, flubendazole and moxidectin are drugs that are undergoing serious testing as a microfilaricide. Flubendazole is known to inhibit the functioning of tubulins, and then moxidectin actually acts on glutamate-gated chloride channels. Moxidectin has gone through phase 1, 2, and phase 3 trials are being completed, but there seem not to be much excitement about moxidectin killing the adult worm or being a cure for Onchocerciasis. When it was reported that moxidectin may be a microfilaricide, people jubilated, but for quite some time now, clinical trials are happening, but the type of excitement you get is not really happening in the literature. Flubendazole is one molecule that does not kill this parasite in vitro. We've done some experiments with flubendazole derivatives and so on. It doesn't kill the parasite in vitro, but in vivo, there is killing. Killing is reported for the adult worms. And clinical trials with moxidectin are supported by the WHO, and that drug is actually coming from Wyeth Pharmaceuticals. DNDi and Anacor Pharmaceuticals, with funding from the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, are actually involved in the flubendazole studies, and they are looking at different versions of that molecule, derivatives, to see whether they will to get a better drug. And this is in collaboration also with the University of California, San Francisco, where we have the Marquero Group, and Judy Sakanari, who is sitting behind there. is also fully involved. Other experimental macrophyllaricides include gold complexes, oxaborols by Anarcho Pharmaceuticals, and they will have quite a number of drugs that are already in veterinary use or even human use and that have been approved by the FDA. They are currently being tested, repurposing, repositioning. And this includes Closantel, which was tested and published by the group of Kim Janda. But you see, the list is really short, reflecting the neglected nature of this disease. And we want to say that the development of macrophyllaricides has taken off just recently. I mean, Sarah's talking about getting a macrophyllaricide for onchocerciasis, and this is thanks to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation that kindly, you know, started giving out grants, and we have so many groups now involved in looking for a macrophyllaricide for onchocerciasis. This happened not too long ago. And it's perhaps the largest funder for macrophyllaricide development in onchocerciasis, the Gates Foundation. Diethyl carbamazine is also a drug that was tried for treatment of onchocerciasis, but it was only a microphyllaricide. It was effective, but the effect was so, the activity was so rapid that it became a problem. And so those who took diethyl carbamazine had serious reaction, immunological reaction, known as a Majorti reaction. And this reaction was so severe that, so fierce that, the drug actually received a local name called man pass man. Man pass man is like pigeon for, we're going to see who is more than who, whether the person is more than is stronger than the drug, or the drug stronger than the. So when you are going in for diethyl carbamazine, it was like you were going in for war. Short-amine was found to be partially macrophyllaricide. It was a macrophyllaricide that was used for some time, but it was later on found to be only partially macrophyllaricide, and so it was also abandoned because of neurotoxicity. So it had two problems. First, it was not fully macrophyllaricide, and then it was neurotoxic. People who took short-amine later on became ill again. Now, this has to do with the current screening methods and models for onchocerciasis. We know that the pharmaceutical model relies heavily on biochemical and cell-based screening against validated targets. When it comes to onchocerciasis, the phenotypic screening is possibly the only method available, or the most common popular method in use. And the bovine model, Onchocerca Ochengi, is known to be best for this disease. And at the University of Buea in Cameroon, our research on Onchocerca drug discovery is focused primarily on this parasite from cows, Onchocerca Ochengi. So the lack of a suitable animal model, small animal model, is a huge problem for onchocerciasis drug discovery and development. Because the cow is so large, and if you had to do in vivo testing, then you need a huge amount of material, you know, in terms of cost of goods, getting the drug for testing, because you're not going to be using just one cow. Anyway, going to use quite a lot of cows, all the controls, and so on. Mouse model for microphyllaricide exists, and so we really need to get a small animal model for testing macrophyllaricides. That is a gap as far as onchocerciasis drug discovery is concerned. Now, we will look at efforts at the ANDI Centre of Excellence for Onchocerciasis Drug Research at the University of Buea. ANDI is acronym for African Network for Drugs and Diagnostics Innovation. It was born out of the WHO TDR and was recently hosted by UNECA. They were looking for a new host, UNECA, United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, based in Addis Ababa, in Ethiopia. And it was formed to be a network of health networks in Africa. And the goal was to promote and sustain discovery and development of new drugs, diagnostics, and vaccines within Africa, and of course, in partnership with Western pharmaceutical companies. 32 centers of excellence were recognized, of which we were one. And the center of excellence are Pan-African Center and open to collaborations. Our center at the University of Buea is the leading laboratory of the biotechnology unit of the Faculty of Science, of which I also head. And University of Buea is a government institution created in 1993 with about 17,000 students and has programs from BSc to PhD in health sciences and also in biomedical sciences. So it's a full-fledged university. And for those of you who don't know much about Cameroon, you see here a map. This is a map of Africa, the African continent, and then this is Cameroon. And within Cameroon, we see the position of Buea. This is the Atlantic Ocean. And then the port city of Douala is here, which is also the economic capital. So Buea is about 60 to 90 minutes drive from the, about 90 minutes drive from the airport. And this is a picture of the University of Buea campus. We see the Mount Cameroon, which is 4,070 meters above sea level in the background. The Buea is actually at the foot of that mountain. And then we see here the laboratory, the ANDI Centre of Excellence. This is the new lab of that center and the culture room being set up. And we have quite a number of techniques in place, you know, on the ground for people who would like to visit our laboratory or center. We have cell and tissue culture techniques, parasites, Onchocerciasis species, lower cultures, in vitro and vivo drug screens, medicinal plants and natural products, isolation and characterization, immunology and immunochemistry techniques. So we do. We have done quite a lot of work on diagnosis, immunodiagnosis, also molecular techniques, classical molecular epidemiology techniques, general molecular biology techniques, including PCR, SGS, page blotting, and all of that, protein chemistry and purification techniques, enzymology, and basic bioinformatics. We have a rather large laboratory, which is enough to host 15 investigators working at a time, an animal facility that can hold about 500 mice, a few research stations for onchocerciasis, loisis, tuberculosis, malaria, and we have access to patients, and then currently we have quite a number of IRBs already obtained to get samples and parasites for onchocerciasis and loisis. Loisis studies. And the laboratory is linked to the internet and has its own connection directly to the national provider. And but our most important problem now is lack of some capital intensive pieces of equipment which we can use to foster, to move our work on natural products forward. The projects we have in the laboratory include a GCE Round 11 grant to develop a small animal model for testing the efficacy of onchocerciasis macrofilaricides on lower microfilaria. Because the fact that a drug does not kill lower in vitro does not mean that it will not kill in vivo. So we want to get an in vivo test to verify that effective lack of killing. Then we are producing Onchocerciasis vulvulus infective stage larvae, L3, to support metabolomic studies for diagnosis. This is in collaboration with Tom Nordman of NIH, and also to support screening for Onchocerca macrofilariasis in collaboration with Dr. Sarah Lou Stigman of the New York Blood Center. And then we are screening compounds on Onchocerca and lower worms. We have access to that. And again, we see the collaborators here, Jim Makero, Anaco Pharmaceuticals, and we receive funding from the Gates Foundation indirectly, a sub-grant. And then we have a natural product-based drug discovery for onchocerciasis, and there we have some little money coming from the university to do that. Our interest in natural products is because we have, we have medicinal plants which are currently being used to treat the infection. And we have tested extracts from some of those medicinal plants and found them to be really effective. So we want to get to the molecules and trying to see how we can change traditional medicine to orthodox medicine. And so that we can get more people using the drugs. And the Grand Challenge project, like I said, is also, at the end of the day, we hope to help macrofilariasis development pipelines. You know, people who are working on in this area, this assay would have been developed, we will be interested in getting compounds from them for testing. And we have been able to screen over 5,000 pure compounds obtained from industrial partners, including the WHO, TDR, Anaco Pharmaceutical, Celgene, and many labs. Some of them are existing drugs, repurposing. A few hundred hits have been identified so far, and the IC50s, the IC50 of many of them have been determined. And some of those IC50s are really low, and give us the hope that in the medium term, short in the medium to long run, maybe the cure for onchocerciasis will be on the pharmacy shelf. But like the pharmaceutical experts will tell us, drug discovery is a very lengthy process and also very risky. We have worked on more than 20 medicinal plants already. We have isolated some pure molecules, but we've tested more than 75 crude extracts, and about 75% of those extracts are found to be active against the adult worms. And so the problem now remains to go within the extracts and look for what is active there. Some people have argued that there is no need purifying the molecules. We could just use the extract like that. After all, if you use it as a complex mixture, maybe it will prevent the problem of resistance developing because you have so many molecules in the extract. If this one does not kill the parasite, maybe the other one will. And some say that when it comes to multi-drug resistance, like the case of extensively drug resistant tuberculosis, maybe the solution there is some traditional concoction. You know, just use brute force, more or less, to get the thing off before it spreads. We are developing new assays we're trying to get new assays for the in vivo assays. The focus now is on in vivo assays because we already developed in vitro assays, which were validated by the expert drug advisory committee of the WHO TDR, and of course, the case of the in vivo assay for lower microfilaria has already been stated. This is an example of the results we get when we screen adult worms. If you look at this slide, these are actually worms. These are worm masses. It's just that the worms we have not tried to disentangle. This is coming from the nodule. Of course, you see the thread here. This is actually a worm. So when you do this test, you see the case of a drug that kills the parasites sowear to a very low concentration. And when there is no killing, you see the blue coloration. But when there is killing, you see it clear. And so every experiment carries a negative and a positive control. And these are some of the plants we have been working with, working on. Here we find Crateryspermum laurinum, Kigellia africana. We have isolated some good molecules. They prepare some very active extracts from these plants. And so it will be interesting to have collaborators who can work with us to move these extracts forward to see whether we can get, because these are plants that have been used for a very long time, maybe hundreds of years. It's often said that before orthodox medicine, there was traditional medicine. And so people have used some of these traditional medicines for centuries without reports of increased, cancers, increased rates of cancers, for example, in some of those areas. And we should not undermine the importance of some of these plants, because we know that close to 50% of drugs that were registered within a 30-year period, 1980-2010, were either from plant origin, or they were derivatives, or were inspired by natural products from plants, or plants and bacteria, and weeds, and so on. And at times, you get some of those molecules, and they are already so good that you don't need to modify much. I am sure that when Fleming discovered penicillin, we didn't have to go through this rigorous process of drug development that we have today. I'm not sure about that. And so it was, you could get some easy discoveries, especially because you are combining already, combining some knowledge, some traditional knowledge, with modern knowledge which we're going to generate. And the clinical trials, in some cases, have already been accomplished, have already been completed. If you take something like Artemisia annua that was used in China for thousands of years, and then it was later on developed, the artemisinin was later on isolated from there, and currently the molecule of choice to treat malaria. The fact that those people use those, they use that preparation for thousands of years, in some way was already a clinical trial. You know, maybe. And this is an example of an output or a sheet for some of the molecules we're working with. And these molecules actually came from TDR. But you see that we obtained IC50s down to 0.078 micrograms per mil. And so some of those molecules were really good. But the TDR seemed not to have had money to follow up some of these, to follow up these molecules. Because somewhere along the line, TDR decided to go, to leave discovery research and go more into implementation research. And that is what they are doing right now. So some of these molecules really need to move forward, in our opinion. They need to be taken, because some of them were really good and they were not so toxic. They were not so cytotoxic. And we think that that should move forward. These have already been published in PLOS. And if you look at this in PLOS neglected tropical disease, you find this paper where these molecules were actually reported by the group, a group led by, that team was actually led by Solomon Waka, and we were members. And we see here another example where we're screening for lower, and also Onchocerca uchenge. So we're screening in parallel, lower microfilariae, Onchocerca uchenge microfilariae. And when we screen in parallel, it permits us to compare, to look at, to compare the activities, because if at the end of the day it's very difficult to get a drug that will kill only the Onchocerca worm, then we may go to look at differences in IC50s. And so if we find a drug that kills or ovolos at a very low concentration, or it kills ovolos more effectively than it kills lower, I think it can be adjusted such that the killing rate for lower is very slow,
to the extent that we will not have the problem of hypersensitivity against lower coming up. And so it's really important to have that comparison. This is a situation where we have a drug, we have ivermectin. This is comparing the activity of ivermectin on Onchocerca or Cho-Ngwa microfilariae and also on lower microfilariae and Onchocerca or Cho-Ngwa microfilariae. We see that ivermectin is even a lower drug. You see, it kills the lower microfilariae more rapidly than it kills the Onchocerca microfilariae. So, by far, more drugs were active in our screens on the microfilariae than on the adult worms, but some drugs were more active on the adult worms than on the microfilariae. These parasites behave as though the adult worms and the microfilariae behave as though they were completely different organisms at times. You know, you look at it, you ask yourself whether all of them are Onchocerca parasites. The different stages behave as if they are different species. And for adult screens, many compounds were active only on the adult males, motility reduction, and it was usually difficult to kill the females biochemically, relatively more difficult to kill the females. Because we are comparing motility to biochemical killing, inhibition of motility may not necessarily mean death of worms. Interestingly, nearly all the molecules that were active on the adult worms were at least moderately active on the microfilariae. They were either fully active or moderately active on the microfilariae, say nearly all. And screening efforts at this center may yield novel leads and candidates for curing onchocerciasis, but it has to be in collaboration because as an academic laboratory, we do not have the tools required to get these molecules forward. That is, of course, why we are dealing with renowned pharmaceutical companies. So this is a summary of what we can offer our collaborators: access to medicinal plants and microorganisms. You know, in Africa, in that belt, the biodiversity is rather large. You know, I think if you look at that zone of Central Africa, it's not fully characterized, but it's also very high on the list after the Amazon. And then we can screen compounds on onchocerciasis and loisis for our collaborators. We have access to biological material such as sera, parasites, and all of that. And we have few sites for onchocerciasis, malaria, tuberculosis, other tropical diseases. And we can do genotyping in our facilities as well as test new diagnostic, evaluate new diagnostic tests. In acknowledgement, I want to thank these colleagues with whom I've been working. We have Professor Efange, Gabriel Folefo, Gamaya Moses. These are people that we want to thank, especially Dr. Sarah Lou Stigman of the New York Blood Center, Professor Kim Janda, Dr. James Makero, Dr. Solomon Waka, Dr. Bernadette Ramirez, Judy Sakanari, who is sitting behind there, Dr. Simon Townsend in the United Kingdom, who is our collaborator and a friend. The WIPO research team, led by Tom Bombalis in Geneva, BVGH, Jennifer Dent. We have other colleagues sitting here, Rupa and Katie. And then Anaco Pharmaceuticals, University of California, Berkeley, for inviting me to this really important meeting. I'm grateful. And we get financial support from the Gates Foundation, the WHO TDR, New York Blood Center, University of California, San Francisco, NIH, Cell Gene Corporation, as well as the University of Buea. Thank you very much for listening.
Hello. Are you concerned about the resistance development for ivermectin, and then there's actually no other avermectin coming after it?
Sorry? What?
Are you not concerned about, here, the that there could be or there is some resistance developing against ivermectin, and there's no, and it's one of the best control agents you have, and there's no other avermectin following it? There's no backup.
Yeah,
or what is the backup?
It's a very big problem, because that could reverse, you know, decades of achievements. It's a very huge problem. But the problem of ivermectin resistance is still being debated. You know, if you look in the literature, you find so many reports of resistance, but some people are refuting that. With our own studies, well, we don't test, we don't look at all of that, but we know that those studies have really not been conducted to check whether on people, you know, there is really that resistance. No real solid study has been conducted with that. But we are really concerned with that. And so it is up to the pharmaceutical companies to get alternatives, you know, as rapidly as possible so that decades of achievements do not go down the drain just like that.
What is the biological role for the endosymbiont, the Wolbachia, in this condition, in the worm?
Some have suggested that it has the bacterium has a role in nutrition of the parasite, and so if you deplete Wolbachia, you cause the worms to have problems with nutrition. Maybe metabolites, intake, all of those. But that is what is currently being suggested.
Is the same bacterium in the Loa Loa worm? In the other worm that you don't want to kill, does it have the same endosymbiont, the Wolbachia? Do both worms have the same?
Which of the, in lower, lower?
Yes.
No, we don't have, there's no Wolbachia in lower, lower. There's no Wolbachia, but ivermectin is not directed against Wolbachia. Ivermectin is directed against glutamate-gated chloride channels, not against Wolbachia. The drugs that are used to treat Wolbachia are antibiotics, and then it takes time to kill the worm, and that is the main problem. And so that is encouraging researchers to move ahead with the use of, the fact that there is no Wolbachia in lower, lower, encouraging researchers to look for better antibiotics. But that is work that is ongoing. And we have the AWOL group, AWOL group, which is also being funded by the Gates Foundation, looking for better antibiotics to use to control onchocerciasis. But like I said, the main problem there is the fact that the killing is so slow. You know, when people take drugs, they want to see action almost immediately, you know. They don't want to wait for weeks to months.
You indicated that in endemic villages, up to 98% prevalence existed. Does that remaining 2% represent a resistant subpopulation?
I said more than 98%. In fact, there was a village where we found everybody infected. It was more like 100% in some village. Okay, but we usually have this small percentage of people, 1 to 2%, who remain infection-free despite lifelong exposure.
And those are known as the putatively immunes. And so people working on vaccines are trying to exploit what those people are reacting, I mean, their immune systems are seeing. And, you know, but getting a vaccine for a complicated, a complex parasite like the Onchocerciasis volvulus has proven to be very difficult. Very difficult. So yes, there is some resistance, you know, characterized as, I mean, commonly known as putative immunity. And there's also some level of concomitant immunity, because in an endemic area we find parasitemia or microfilaridemia on the number of nodules, which represent the adult worm population, increasing up to about 30 to 40 years for the infected in age. After 30 to 40 years, we see the number, you know, the numbers leveling off. So there is some immunity to super infection happening. So there's concomitant immunity in onchocerciasis. But, you know, the fact that you can have a village with everybody infected means that that immunity is really, really poor.
Are there any strong predators of the black fly that could be distributed and maybe slow the spread? Up over here. So any strong predators of the black fly to slow the spread of this disease? Maybe they could be spread out around those villages.
The black fly, you're talking about the, sorry, I didn't get you.
So the bug that's spreading this disease.
The spreading?
Yes.
Of the black fly. Yeah, the black fly is really energetic. It's an energetic fly, and it is known to go 15 to even 100 kilometers from their breeding site. And so if you want to really eliminate onchocerciasis, it has to be a regional issue, you know, a regional solution. Because if you go to one country, if you go to Cameroon, for example, and you eliminate onchocerciasis, if you go to Nigeria and eliminate it, black flies from Cameroon will repopulate that country. And so it brings the whole thing down to north. And this is already happening in Ghana, in West Africa, where we had the OCP, African Program for Onchocerciasis Control. At one point, they were jubilating that the black flies were almost completely eliminated. But when they stopped the control, there was serious repopulation. And the disease came back, more or less.
Thank you.